WVTM 13 Chronicle presents Alabama's Black History.
Hello, everybody. I'm Guy Rawlins.
I'm Lisa Crane.
And I'm Eunice Elliott. We're here at Kelly Ingram Park, the very center of the Civil Rights District here in Birmingham.
More than a century before the fight for civil rights took center stage here, the last known slave ship to arrive in America dropped anchor on Alabama's coast.
And with no way to get home, the slaves created their own community in Mobile.
Larissa Scott shares the stories of the descendants of those slaves who still live in Alabama in a little-known community called Africatown.
Tucked away in the northeast corner of Mobile. Made up of 5 square miles with 5 neighborhoods and about 3,000 people. But the number that most defines Africatown is 110.
The 110 Africans who were captured and bought here.
On the Clotilda, the last slave ship to arrive in the United States in 1860. Historians say the biggest landowner in Mobile County, Timothy Mayer, made a bet to
bring a boatload of slaves right here to the country, even though it was illegal.
With 110 people chained on board, he sailed from West Africa across the Atlantic to the Mobile Tensaw River Delta. Mayer is said to have burned the ship to hide the evidence. The wreckage was never found.
The gully back behind the school, that's where, after they brought the slave off the boat, they hid them back there for about a week away from the feds.
After the Civil War ended, the slaves were set free. Historians say their former owner, Mayer, gave them land where the free slaves then founded Africatown.
I'm a direct descendant, 6th generation of Charlie Lewis. Cudjoe Lewis's brother.
That history felt in every corner of the town, one of the last and largest communities with direct descendants of slaves.
These are the actual slave quarters. My great-grandmother lived here and her sister lived across, I don't want to say street, across the road.
Freed slaves built the Mobile County Training School.
And so this is the school that they built?
This is the school that they established, yeah.
And a church.
Union Baptist, this is the church that they established after they all got here.
Across the street from the church sits the graveyard where most of Africatown's founders and their descendants are buried, a powerful reminder of this community's past.
They're faced toward the east, and that's the direction that Africa is. And so the legend goes, they always wanted to go back home, so that's the way that they're facing.
It's taken the descendants a long time to talk about how they got here.
I think it may have been like a fear for people to talk about it. People knowing about your history.
But now they're ready.
They need to know why it's called Africatown.
Wanting to preserve what's sacred while sharing the history of their ancestors.
History is important. We need to pass it on to our children so they can know where they're from and where they're going.
People like Ryan Noble and Joel Lewis Billingsley are telling the world in a documentary.
We always hear about victims of slavery or, you know, those kinds of things, but these were heroes of that story, and they're heroes, they're American heroes.
It's a story that allows for you to really feel the pain, the suffering, and the desiring to go home.
This is personal for Billingsley, who is a direct descendant of Cudjoe, also pronounced Cudjoe, Lewis, who lived the longest and is memorialized in Africatown.
Cudjoe's story was very much integrated into my entire life.
Using these powerful stories to change people's perspectives.
If we can think about how far we've been able to come from that point in history, hopefully there's also hope and inspiration and strength to think about how far we can move in future generations.
A tiny town in Alabama deserving a big place in American history. In Mobile, Larissa Scott, WVTM 13.
Last year, a team of archaeologists traveled to Mobile to examine the charred remains of a wooden boat believed to be the Clotilda. Now, they determined those remains weren't likely those of the slave ship. However, a team of divers is now searching nearby areas for remnants.
With few stories of places like Africatown, there are some who say schools are not doing enough to educate children about our country's troubling past. A 2018 study shows that slavery is not taught enough in schools, and when it is included, it is not adequately portrayed.
It's very uncomfortable.
Because it's scary.
Those are some of the reasons Alabama School of Fine Arts teachers Ashley Jones and Koya Maples think teachers aren't teaching slavery correctly in schools.
Often we want to soften those parts of history.
People assume, even students assume, that guilt has to be assigned every time the subject matter comes up.
A study by the Southern Poverty Law Center says U.S. education on American slavery is lacking and that students just aren't learning enough about it.
People just aren't really delving into it as much as they should and really dealing with the reality of what it was.
Maple says she sees evidence of this in her classroom.
When I do have these conversations with students, I find that there are so many gaps in their knowledge.
Filling those gaps is crucial in understanding today's society.
If we're to move forward, if we are to heal as a society, we need to understand where we've come from.
Political, social, and economic issues can all be linked back to slavery that teachers say students should learn in school.
I just try to make sure I always tell them the truth and not sugarcoat it, because I really think we do too much of that in the South and as a nation, and that's why we're still kind of facing the same issues over and over again, because we're not actually telling each other the truth.
Jones and Maples say it all starts with teachers finding materials that start meaningful discussions in every subject and going beyond only teaching slavery during Black History Month.
It is American history. It's a human issue, and it's something that all humans need to understand.
Since that study was released, the Southern Poverty Law Center says it's seen some encouraging changes. Both Illinois and Massachusetts have updated their social studies curriculum to include American slavery, and districts around Alabama say they are willing to do the same.
Birmingham is home to many celebrated icons and unsung heroes. One in particular, Dr. Jesse Lewis. He's a pioneer in his own right, whose business savvy helped Lewis break racial barriers as a successful entrepreneur. Dr. Jesse Lewis.
Trucking company, recording. A studio.
Kind of sounds like a character from Forrest Gump.
Real estate, firm, grocery.
When listening to successful businesses he started over the years, there were 17 of them.
I've been in business all my life.
The high school dropout started making money at an early age. He had to, in a family of seven kids, raised by his illiterate but business-minded grandmother.
Every day, each one of them had to go somewhere and make a 20 cents or 50 cents a dollar, whatever it is. They do something to bring it home.
He left home at 16 and joined the Army. He used a GI Bill to finish high school and his first college degree at Miles College in 3 years. He also studied at Alabama, NYU, Troy State, and earned his doctorate at Atlanta University. Still, he says,
and I'm not that smart. But I just use a thought process on everything that I do.
And that process proved useful. He started America's first Black-owned marketing and PR company in the mid-50s and convinced Coca-Cola to advertise to what was then called the Negro market.
They told me that Black people didn't buy Coca-Cola, and I said, you're right. They don't buy Coca-Cola because you never asked them to buy Coca-Cola.
Lewis helped produce the very first Coca-Cola ad targeting Blacks, featuring Black talent, but didn't always get the acknowledgement he craved because of his race.
I would write the commercial, give it to them, and I didn't get no credit. All right. And the president of a Golden Flake and told me one day, said Jesse, if you were white, you'd be rich. I said I'm not gonna never be white, but what's wrong with me being rich Black?
You know you're kind of a big deal when your name's on the building and the business you started decades ago is right next door and still running strong.
They have carried this paper to another level.
He also tried his hand at politics, working in the cabinet for Governor George Wallace, an unpopular decision.
I was severely criticized by the Black community. And my thoughts were that you you can't help nobody on the outside looking in.
He's won at business and politics, and now at 94 years old, he still runs three companies and walks the golf course a couple times a week. Even on the links, he hates to lose.
If you tell me you're a cheerful loser, something wrong with you.
And Dr. Lewis shared this theory with me. He said, the harder you work, the luckier you get. You don't have to be the smartest guy in the world, but it takes hard work to see that kind of success.
A tragic event in a doctor's waiting room helped change one Alabama woman's career path forever. Coming up, we'll tell you how Dr. Sandra Ford is giving back to communities that need it most.
And as we go to break, we want to recognize an Alabama woman making history in the skies. Second Lieutenant Kayla Freeman is the first black female pilot in the Alabama National Guard. Lieutenant Freeman graduated from Fort Rucker's Army Aviation School and is currently deployed in the Middle East as a platoon leader. She says it was discipline, perseverance, and faith that helped her reach her goals. Stay with us. You're watching Alabama's Black History.